Michael Baldinger, sustainable investing is a fairly new area of finance. You yourself, of course, are a former Wall Street trader. When do you think that the institutional mainstream is going to sort of wake up to this trend?
Yeah. Look, what we have seen is really regionally dependent, but we see already today that it has become mainstream. We see some of the most sophisticated, largest asset owner, pension fund manager, really apply sustainable investment criteria in their investment processes today. So I would say it is mainstream already today in many areas of the world.
Now you mentioned the regionality. I have to ask you what that looks like when you break it down into the US, Europe, Asia.
Yeah, I mean, the numbers are large. We talk about a 23 trillion number now that doubled over the last 5-6 years, and 2/3 is Europe.
So that's an industry number.
That's an industry number, an official number. Everybody looks at those numbers. And Europe is 2/3 of it. United States is 1/3. But important to mention that the growth rate in the United States is 3 times as fast as Europe. So you would expect over time, in the next couple of years, U.S. will be in the lead. And then Asia is very fragmented. But there is Japan particularly, which is very promising development in that marketplace.
And of course, I'm guessing that's a pension fund-driven development in Japan?
Yes, absolutely. It's really the largest investor in the world, GPIF, the Japanese pension fund. And the CIO, Hiro Mizuno, is really out there talking about sustainability. So he's really kind of a pop star for us in the industry. So he really makes a big difference for a very important, very large market, obviously, Japan.
What's it look like in wider Asia?
It's again fragmented. You have China, and China's more, more they invest tangibility, more like in thematics. So if you live in Beijing, for example, and you haven't seen a blue sky for a couple of years, you start to think, do I have to hedge something with an investment in renewable energies? Or if you have a large population, as China has, and still growing over 2 billion people, so how can I make sure to feed my people in a secure way? So then you might invest something like food security, something like that. So it's really more a tangible and a thematic-related investment in China.
And of course, UBS, the largest wealth manager in the world, $2.2 trillion in assets, as we just saw from a recent study. Can you help me understand what part of UBS's overall asset base would I be able to find in the sustainable or impact area that you oversee?
Yeah, I mean, first of all, this is a great, great strive, and top-down, really, driven by our chairman, Axel Weber, Sergio Motti, Uli Kernan, also an asset management CEO, who drive this. And we want to be the leader in this field, and that shows also in daily work what we do. In asset management, we have approximately $800 billion in assets, so really a large, big asset manager. And out of that, we have focus products where we create SI focus products, which have doubled in the last year, so we have a really good part in that already. But the priority for us right now is the integration part, where we want to integrate environmental, social, governance factors in everything what we do in active management.
So within the asset management division,
exactly.
You're trying to embed those criteria.
In our research process, make it a norm. There's nothing ideological. It's really a norm how we look at companies before we make an investment. And that will mean by end of this year already, we'll have transformed our entire active managed business and integrated ES and G into our investment process. And this is something at this scale has never been done before in the industry. And that is really a game changer for us and also for Switzerland as such and as a global asset manager. So very proud of that.
That's quite impressive. And that's fixed income and equities.
Equities active managed by end of this year. And that's a big part of our assets. Yeah. Okay. So that's very important for us.
That's very impressive. Now you've been with UBS for, I think, nearly 2 years now. You joined in 2016. You, of course, were the CEO of Robeco Sam, one of the leading sustainable asset management boutiques. Based here in Switzerland. Mm-hmm. Can you tell me a little bit about what it's like going from a small boutique, which is just focused on this, to, as I say, a $2.2 trillion asset manager that probably has a lot of different priorities and might be difficult to navigate in this particular direction?
Yeah, I mean, I'm asking many times the question, why did you leave your CEO job at a really wonderful company? But what I've seen over time is now that the largest asset owners in the world really get their arms around sustainable investing, and they need liquidity, they need scale to really apply large sums of money in this field, and you need a global asset manager like UBS asset manager. You need the investment engine, you need the global expertise, so really full-fledged global franchise what we have. So that's what we have, and so we really can customize solutions for clients. We come up with the right solutions, and that is important for me. And for me to come to a big firm is it's sometimes maybe a little bit slower at the beginning because it's a big machine, I must say, but a lot of talented people. But if the machine is running, then it's really very powerful. And we really move the needles and we see that when we recruit people, it is really very powerful what we can do and how important it is. And people look at us, you know, as a leader in this field, what we're doing. And that is fun. And that is the big difference. But the complexity definitely comes with a big bank, of course. Yeah.
Well, that does lead me to my next question as well, because banks for the last few years have really had to fight for talent, especially from the tech industry, which is seen, especially by graduates, as a much, much more attractive sector to work in. I mean, how are you getting that talent that you need?
Yeah. And that's really an excellent point you're raising. You know, we tried with dress code changes in the late 90s in New York. I remember that. There was a clear answer to Silicon Valley. How can you attract those kids? So you can go in blue jeans, everything from the black dark suits that I'm wearing right now. But I think it is really excellent to have sustainability as a leading theme within a firm. I'll give you an example. We just filled 20 positions in our field in my department over the last 9 months. We had over 6,000 applications just for those 20 jobs. That shows what goes on, how people think, not only young kids from the great schools out there, but also more senior people, how attractive this is for us as an answer to Silicon Valley. And I always say, look, this is the Silicon Valley finance, what we're doing, sustainable impact investing, because there's so much innovation coming out of this field. It's tangible. It has impact on society, next to returns. I think it's a very attractive business proposition for financial firms like UBS.
That was very impressive. We look forward to watching how that plays out in the future.
Absolutely.
Thank you very much, Michael Baldinger.
Thank you.